Hi, good afternoon, everyone. Can you hear me okay?
Yep,
fantastic. So my name's Jamie Tait, and I'm from Vodafone Group. My role is the Global Head of Learning and Development. So essentially, I'm responsible for ensuring we have the right capabilities across our different organisation units. I don't pretend. I think the first thing to fess up about is I'm not an expert. So I'm 15 years in HR, but more from a generalist point of view. It's only in recent years that I've started to kind of deepen my interest and curiosity in the L&D space. My story today, I'll keep it short and sweet. It's about how we've developed a really nice digital learning experience for employees across the globe. So we've been working quite hard across Vodafone to try to simplify things, try to make it more digital, and I want to just show you a few examples. Very much from the practitioner's point of view, so I've just taken screen grabs. I'm just going to tell you about what we did and why we did it, and hopefully some of those things resonate or you take some ideas from it as well. Vodafone, hopefully most of you know, we've been around 25 years, started just above a curry shop in Newbury out west, but now grown into one of the largest telecommunications company in the world, with around 480 million customers and 130,000 employees. So I have, I think, 5 points I'd like to mention. The first thing that I think, and it's maybe the thing we struggled with most, is the simplicity of access. So I think about our population. We've got a big demographic of people across retail stores, in call centres, or out in the field, people who are engineers or B2B sales people. And they don't have time to go and connect on the laptop to do e-learnings or come in the classroom. And to be honest, most of our solutions force you to do that. You have to have a laptop, you have to be in the corporate network, you have to come into the LMS, and it's hard. And even with the best intentions, we've got a global team, we've got local learning teams in every country, we've built all these solutions and we've bought all these solutions from external companies. And actually, me and my team sat down and said, actually, let's add all these things up. What does it look like? And there was like 20, 30 different access points that people go to for learning, a sort of spaghetti mess of learning solutions. And we said, nah, we need to fix this. It's got to be much simpler. It's got to be digital. And you've got to be able to access your learning wherever you want, whenever you want, on whatever device you choose. So it's been a big focus for us in the last year to strip out learning management systems, strip out websites, portals, tools, get one simple learning management system in the background, and we've built in-house this sort of one integrated platform that pulls everything together. So it's really easy for the end user. The second piece that comes with this is personalization. So we've been really guilty in the past of just chucking learning out to 130,000 employees and hoping that something sticks. I mean, how silly is that, right? And then not being happy when our KPIs, our numbers aren't, our usage levels aren't that high. So part of this new platform we've built uses the data that we've already got, right? But it just makes it easier for us. So on the small screen here, if I'm a new user, I'm a new employee, then I come into my learning environment and it already knows me. It knows what language I want it in. It knows that, hi, it's Jamie, what do you want to do? And just then, I put in some simple learning preferences, the things that's important to me, my job, my career sort of interests. And then on the big screen on the right there, that's what it feeds me through. So, I mean, you probably struggle to see it, but it's saying it knows that I've come back. It's filtered my preferences, so actually it knows that I'm in HR and I want a few more HR-related courses. And it's pulled me up HR analytics, because that's something I've been reading recently. And sort of rather worryingly, it wants me to do some anti-bribery training. But that's sort of what I apparently need. But the goal for us here is moving away from chucking learning to everyone to having almost like an Amazon-type experience, where as a learner, you get something individual to you, sort of special to you, and most importantly, relevant. Next thing is, it's like, we think learning, especially when it's digital stuff, you're out of the classroom, it's got to be really fun, engaging, and memorable. So I just took three sort of screen grabs here. First one, this one here, if you can see it, it's a little man, or kid, jumping across stuff outside a fire station. Any ideas why we might want to use this for different populations, or what sort of context we might use this in? Yeah, absolutely. It is. This actually comes from our customer experience training, so predominantly our retail training. The problem we had was we had all of our guys and girls coming in, doing the retail training, disappearing off the store, and then just forgetting everything, as you do. So we wanted to make it a fun, easy way for people to sort of recall some of their training and not have to worry about lots of translations and this and that. So we simply bought some games, actually a provider downstairs gave them to us for not so much of an investment. It wasn't so much a gift, but we acquired them. And very simply, just put in some of our own content, our own questions, a Vodafone layer over it. And the guys in the retail store loved it. You're talking an average age of like 22 across our retail environment. But it just helped embed all the sort of concepts that we did in our classroom. And they just love playing the games. In order to get more levels, you have to pass some of the questions that you would know having done the training. The middle one, that's a screen grab from our compliance training. Everyone hates compliance training, don't they? I mean, no one likes to be told what they have to do. So we just did a very simple sort of snakes and ladders. This was more a traditional build, an HTML5 e-learning type based one. But again, response was really positive. People liked doing it. They felt like they were playing a game. And we sort of got people to do what we needed them to, whilst not making it such a dull subject. The last one is, actually the image is from Google Images, but the little thing on the guy's screen is our virtual reality example. So the problem we have is our network isn't something you can sort of go and see, really. It's virtual. And a lot of our people coming into the company struggle to get the concept of what our network is, how it works, and why it's important to us. So we've created a virtual reality environment to sort of bring it to life, so people go inside the network, see the possibilities of it, see what it does, which is a fun, cool thing for people to do. Gamification you'll have heard loads about in the last couple of days, I'm sure, so I will not labour the sort of pros and cons, just to show you a couple of examples of how we've used it. First one here was coming out of a sales product, so a B2B sales product app. The problem we had was our sales guys weren't investing a lot of time in learning the latest products, and when the products were getting more and more technical, they were struggling to sort of understand them. So we took a load of resources, put them into an app, created a sort of gamified and leaderboard style, and what we learned was actually our sales guys love it. The top ranking people were often our sales directors, which sent a really good message across the rest of the organization, because they're saying, this is cool, we like doing it. And we put, this tool was called Sales Ready, was the brand we put onto it. And when you achieve certain statuses, it showed up on your account. So you could either be not ready, or you could be almost ready, you could be sales ready, or you could be born ready. And of course, all the sales directors were like, I was born ready. So it just very simple, but worked really nicely. The other example is we're trying to encourage more coaching and regular feedback. And what we sort of found was that people who were coaching the direct employees didn't get a lot back, actually, in terms of feedback. And we wanted to provide a bit more encouragement and continuous improvement around that coaching cycle. So this example is where, as a coachee, you can give feedback, you can give badges to your coach. And Scott, in this example, can pick up badges for giving great feedback, for making me think, as he progresses towards his legendary coach status. So we've just rolled this out across some of our customer operations, our call centers, and our retail store, and it's working really well. Last point that I'd like to make is, all those things are great. So all the gamification, all the personalization, it enhances the experience, but of course it comes back to having just great content. But I think all of us have choices that we make, right? You can either do stuff internally or you do stuff externally. So internally, this is, again, some of our sales-related stuff. This was really simple. So we have a bunch of salespeople who are are good, but they all have different experiences. So we created an environment where they could share their own experiences. They could capture their own videos. They could put on little facts and figures to help their community in line with the little leaderboards that I showed. And it's really helped. So now that we have this platform, we've created almost a mini certification round it. And when we run our numbers, we see that our sales guys, B2B sales guys, who go and do their digital learning certification, they're between 7 and 15% up on the revenue numbers versus those who don't. And this solution cost us like a couple of K to put together. So it's sort of really transformed just the sales capability. But on the other hand, it took quite a lot of time. The big screen is when we've chosen to go externally. So as a business, and like lots of you, we're trying to enhance our digital capabilities. We're trying to change our mindset of our employees in this rapidly changing digital world. So we had the choice. We could try to create our own content, develop our own videos, try to engage our subject matter experts. But actually, we went back out into the industry, found in this example of Vado, who provided really great content and a really nice platform, and we brought it in sort of no time at all. Feedback's been great. And again, I wanted to share it because lots of us have this dilemma of, is it internal, is it external, where do I go? You walk downstairs in the sort of bear pit of suppliers, and there's just too many things, and everyone promising you this sort of silver bullet. I don't believe there is. I think you have to sort of pick and choose and put things together in a way that makes sense for your end users. So look, my closing summary is the things that I've sort of learned in the last couple of years with Vodafone was really important to have flexibility for access. So your employees should be able to access the learning anytime, any place, on whatever device they choose, and not because you've got, you know, LMSs in place. Should be personalized, unique and relevant to the individual. Make it fun, make it memorable. The engaging design is important. Gamification helps, not on everything, but use it in the right situation. And of course, you know, the content is sort of king, and it's got to make a difference to your business. So my five little tips.
Perfect. Thank you. All right, Richard.
Hello, my name's Richard, and I work for the CII, better known as the Chartered Insurance Institute. The first thing I realized when I looked at the schedule here is I would be the person keeping you away from the bar. So I apologize in advance. The CII, Chartered Institute, Insurance Institute, is a professional body. We're the world's largest insurance professional body for insurance and financial planning. We're based in about 150 different countries. I manage a product called Broker Assess. Now, Broker Assess, in simplistic terms, is a heck of a lot of content and an LMS. And we sell this to insurance companies and to insurance brokers. There are about 50,000 individuals that actually use Broker Assess, mainly in the UK. The challenge, really, the reason I'm here today is to talk you through a journey that I started about two and a half years ago. And it was all around increasing usage of Broker Assess. I'm sure there are lots of you in this room today who have an LMS and who face the same challenge. First of all, I'd like to paint a picture of actually who use it. This is where, I mean, there are a lot of similarities between Jamie's challenge and my challenge. The one that's probably most different is who uses it. So we have companies who have 10,000 staff to those that have two or one. The average age, well, there isn't one. It could be anything from 16 to 70. And the customers within the customers, they vary too. So it could be anything from the owner to head of compliance, director of operations. They're hard ones. In fact, they're the most hard. HR, L&D, risk, you name it. So that's basically the makeup of our customer. The challenge we had or we faced was really, I mean, although income is important to us, it's by far not the most important thing for a company like ours. It's actually providing service so that members and other people can actually earn CPD. So we have to provide something other than just the exams and everything else that we have. Income had actually stagnated and it hadn't really moved for 3 years. And if that's a measure, then it's a measure, I guess, that no one else is actually buying it. The scarier thing was usage. Usage was really low. In fact, it was probably limited to about 4% of all the courses that we had on the system. And given the fact that we have about 500 courses on the system, that was quite telling. What was even scarier was that these courses were all compliance related. And I'm talking about the general compliance type courses. So DPA, anti-money laundering, those sorts of things. It's even scarier now because all that content, we actually licensed through a third party. So we were in quite a difficult predicament. And we had lots of what I consider to be pretty good technical or product courses, but they were old and they looked old. On talking to customers, they came up with four things, really, that we really needed to do. One was time. Time was a challenge to them. Conversations I had with pretty big organizations were, yeah, we do DPA training once a year. Do you do anything else? Any other form? Bribery and corruption? Whatever. Nope. We only have time for one. Other companies, operational people mean sort of limit us to around four courses a year, once a quarter. That's the reality of the situation. So I began to really get a picture here that how the heck do you get people to get beyond this step, and therefore how could we possibly increase usage? So there was the time element. The second was relevance. Our courses tended to be generic. Of course, we use subject matter experts who would write us a piece on commercial property, for example. But it was from a generic perspective. So we knew we had to do something about that. Also, the way we presented our learning was horrific. It was just alphabetical in a long list. Well, good luck trying to find something. The reporting. Reports are so critical to anything that particularly that we do. But the reporting was just horrendous. You can imagine actually presenting reports, just one long list of Excel. It doesn't tell a story. And so people didn't really invest any time in actually looking at that. And finally, it was navigation. Navigating the system, again, was pretty difficult. You have to remember that we're dealing with people quite often who may only touch the system once every 3 to 6 months. So when they come back into the system, they really, really have forgotten how to use it. 25% of the functionality of the system was actually being used. I mean, we had super admin access, so we could actually go in and have a look at what they were doing. So that was really our challenge, was basically how can we grow the usage of Assess over a reasonable period of time, so a year. Now, the plan was based to sort the content out, and we did this by looking at what we had and deciding, frankly, we couldn't stay with it. So we rewrote everything from scratch. That's 500 courses and about 5,000 multiple choice questions. This was the basis for everything that we would go through afterwards, so this took a while. The other thing we did, we designed catalogs that were quite intuitive. So for example, if it was aimed at, you know, sort of onboarding, we made it clear that, you know, this was for onboarding, this was for progression, and then they were product-based catalogs. Within those product-based catalogs, so as an example, commercial property insurance, we created courses that were aimed at specific roles rather than just write generic courses. So, for example, in our business, broking is a role. Broking is selling. Underwriting is pricing. And claims, well, we all know what claims is. So each course basically was aimed at a specific product from a role perspective with supporting questions. The challenge of time was the biggest one. And we worked quite closely here with our platform provider, who are called Unicorn. And frankly, had we not had, I suppose, a supplier that was agile enough to be able to adapt to our ideas, we would have struggled to have delivered this project. From a time perspective, it was trying to get customers to perhaps, instead of just using four courses a year, looking at maybe 10, 12, 14, how could we get there? So we created this system that basically had four elements. The first one was an automatic pathway builder. The second element was a diagnostic. Then we had the learning, and then we had post-assessments. So if you can imagine choosing five courses, for example, normally standard financial crime type courses will probably take you an hour each to go through. That's 5 hours. So by actually adding these courses to, we have a basket, just like Amazon's, you drop all your learning in there and then it generates a pathway. The first thing the learner sees is a diagnostic. And the diagnostic basically pulls questions from the courses. So in this instance, we would ask five questions. And I'll go on to say why in a second, but five questions. They are then exempted from any of the learning if they pass the required level. So if you set it at 80%, five questions, four, if they get four right, they don't have to do the learning. Where there is learning they have to do, that's automatically added to their to-do list. Now, why five questions? Well, first of all, it depends what you're looking for. What we found is that if you're looking for risk within your business, five questions is probably enough. If you're looking for competency, you probably need to look at 10 or more. It's subjective, I know, but it's the approach that we've taken, and it seems to have worked quite well. The other thing that's attached to this is obviously the reporting, and I'll show you a couple of the reports in a second. The reporting, again, is key because it actually shows real-time knowledge within your business. I guess we all have different views on this, and we all have different views, I suppose, on the old tick box exercise, but why not measure people right now? Not their short-term memory after they've just gone through a data protection course or a sanctions course or whatever it might be. Just real-time now. There's an awful lot of data you can get your hands on here and a lot of data that you can actually do something with later. The navigation we fixed, simple, by just signposting and also creating a step-by-step guide. Literally, as somebody clicked on something, we said, now what would you like to do now? Would you like to do this or this? And that improved that massively. Finally, the reporting, I said I just alluded to that, so I'll actually show you how that works. And finally, is getting buy-in at the top. This is a really hard thing to do, but it was critical to what we needed to do. And again, the reporting actually helped develop that. These are the diagnostic reports that we develop. So for this actual example itself here, this company called Unite Insurance has four offices. It has about 250 staff. It has a few departments and a few teams. So the very top cut is what a CEO might see. It's actually the output from five financial crime courses, DPA, money laundering, cybercrime, sanctions, etc. The blue box you see there is the coverage element. So in this instance, that box is full. So we know that everybody that should have taken these courses has taken it. The donut next to it is something that we can fix. So we can set perimeters here, which we have. In this instance, 80% represents the green, 50% and under represents the red. So the first cut to the CEO is, I have a problem because I have an awful lot of red from a financial crime perspective. Just quickly by flicking the filter, we can then have a look at the next layer down hierarchically, which happens to be all the offices, which you can see here, the four offices. So it's quite clear from this that the main perpetrator here is London. So again, it's fairly easy to click on London and have a look within London how the teams within the London office are actually performing. And you can see here that basically, not surprisingly, it's the senior management team that are causing us all the problems, or I should say the PAs or the EAs. And also the other end, which is the liability area. Now, I haven't got time to go through all of this for you, but basically we can go down another layer here. So to the teams within those departments and down to the individuals. We can convert those to CSVs and export it out, and you can manipulate the data as you want. What you're seeing here is actually a real-time view, though, of financial crime knowledge within this company before they've actually undertaken any learning. Now, you could deal with this in one or two ways. You can either say, okay, we're going to run a training course face-to-face, that's fine. We can use the e-learning. That again, that's fine. But it's massively powerful data that can be used, and it gets you buy-in from the top. Once a CEO sees that, they'll want to see it every month. So what we do, we're a little bit cheeky, so we always have the CEO's email address when we set up the hierarchy. So we set up the reports to run every month at a certain time. So the CEO gets this on his or her desk at the beginning of each month. Interesting enough, so does the head of compliance. It's also a 12-month view, because the way we've set this up is that Somebody's score stays up here for 12 months. Once they hit 12 months, they fall off the system and automatically they're added back on, and so the coverage element changes as well. But it's quite a powerful element, and it's worked massively well for us and increased usage as well. So where are we 1 year on? Well, 1 year on from launch, we've trebled usage and we're still growing. We're learning as well, in fairness. I mean, one of the areas that for example, we perhaps assumed rather than did anything about was people would automatically just pick up our enthusiasm and go with it. You need to communicate. So we've actually improved the way that we communicate. And we have a couple of pretty massive projects ongoing at the moment that companies have leapt on. And that usage will grow substantially because of that. Use of functionality has grown as well. People are actually building pathways now. They're building diagnostics, which is great. And they're using the reports, which is also good for us. And there's also been a change in attitude to the tick of the box approach, particularly from senior people. They've really bought into the concept there's actually a way they can get hold of data about knowledge within their companies. I mean, we were really quite keen that they didn't use this to beat people up with, that they actually used it in a positive element and actually took responsibility for the fact that their employees didn't have that knowledge in the first place, which thankfully they have. And finally, really, it's now we're moving on to the next stages. I mean, we're a little bit behind Vodafone, but, you know, that's a great aspiration and a great place to be. So now we're building Assess into an app and various other things, and we're looking at gamification and so forth. So it's, you know, it's still, as far as we're concerned, part of the journey. So thank you very much for listening, and I hope I've not held you back from the bar for too long. Thanks.
Thank you very much. So I think it makes sense just to dive right into the Q&A, and then we'll do a little bit of reflection before we wrap up and get words of advice from our two speakers here. Any questions? Okay, I'm going to bring this over so it gets recorded as well. They can hear you.
I guess initially for Jerry, it might apply to both, but just in terms of, if you like, the treatment of your leadership and how that compares with the, you know, really exciting, buzzy gamification side of things. It must be difficult to span those levels, I imagine, and also in terms of traction.
So, just to clarify, is your sort of question around how we engage with the leadership? Or
yeah, and the way that you present, if you like, the materials, because that, you know, to a 20-year-old is fantastic. It's manna from heaven, isn't it? It's just brilliant. You just want to get in there, but I'm thinking that maybe the top deck have a slightly different response.
I think you're right. So a number of the solutions I shared, our CEOs, for example, across the countries probably aren't spending as much time. I mean, what I've found with our senior team is they still need stuff, but we just approach it in a slightly different way. So for example, the challenge with our knowing some of our more technical products that we sell into businesses, with our sales community, we do it through an app and we do it through videos and games and stuff like that, and that all works nicely. Our CEOs need that as well, but actually with them, what we did was we brought them all together and we spent a couple of days with them going through the products, getting them to play with them, getting them to see the commercial value in them. And in the end, they were sort of learning the same stuff as the sales guys were, but they were just doing it in a way that worked for them. I remember doing it before, speaking to some guys beforehand, and they were saying, why are you bringing CEOs together to show them like the latest, you know, network product? They're going to hate it. And they loved it because they never get a chance to do that sort of stuff. It's always, you know, come here and go to a leadership conference and this, and they're like, we just want to get our hands dirty on our products.
Impressive, Vodafone. I have to say that. It's very impressive to see the journey you have done. I'm just a little bit curious. You are very modern today, as I can see how you're using the digital approach. How has this affected your strategy, learning strategy? And what is your learning strategy?
Yeah, I mean, I'm not sure it's changed it all that much. So a lot of the digital solutions are just channels, you know, so it's how we take stuff out to different communities of people in a way that works for them. A strategy is still to deliver capability that enables our business to do well. You know, whether that's developing new products, improving technology, making better engineers, delivering better customer experience in stores, you know, those are still our fundamental goals. And a few years back, you know, we might have tried to do it in slightly different ways, you know, more classroom stuff, etc. But technology is moving so fast, so we're trying to leverage it where we can and as best we can. And that opens up more channels to us to deliver some quite cool stuff. But I think it's only a channel. The goals are still to make the business better through great people.
So I had a question related to the sales app that you showed within Vodafone. In one of the earlier sessions today, the challenge was brought up around sometimes it takes quite a bit of time to build these type of games or e-learnings and also to keep them future-proof. So I can imagine that within Vodafone, technology changes rapidly as well. So how have you guys ensured that you can be really quick with these learnings, adjust them to kind of your product life cycles?
Mm-hmm. Good question. We have a sort of quite a simple build on it. So it's largely like template-based. A lot of our apps are actually web-based stuff. They just look like apps on the phone, which means it's really simple to run across multiple devices. You get into all sorts of trouble when you're trying to do like native apps on Apple and Android and things like that. So just the setup of it, the infrastructure behind it is really simple. We then also have like multiple administrators in different countries who go and sort of update it, put the product information on it. And there's a huge amount of content from participants themselves. So it's not really that much of a concern for us how to keep it refreshed, because it's just evolving all the time. But I think it helps because the technology behind it is really quite simple.
Richard, do you have thoughts on how you keep up with changes, technology changes like that?
I think our biggest challenge was actually getting to first base, really, and making sure we were. There was a lot of enthusiasm to try and go for games and apps and all of this, but we knew unless we basically sorted ourselves out first, we couldn't move on. And now we are, you know, in about 4 weeks, we'll have our first game, which is quite exciting for us. We were talking about it earlier. But we had to sort that out first, but from there on, who knows?
That I would echo that even in our organization. We're not as advanced as Vodafone, but we've used 3-minute videos, having folks do it just as a starting point, just to create that engagement, because to get to where Vodafone's at is pretty far.
I mean, obviously, it's quite impressive where you've come from and where you got to. Would you see it was a revolution or more of an evolution? Did you stop everything or was it baby steps along the way?
So mostly evolution, I would say. People are just sort of testing stuff out and launching stuff. So in our environment, it's quite common to just go and pilot stuff and see if it works, see if it doesn't. The one bit that I'd say is maybe a little bit more of a revolution is we got to the point where we said we've got to stop all these different systems and tools. It's just too complicated. Where we then got our group HR director to agree, everything stops. We move to just the single learning platform. We cut off, so we set a date and said we're going to cut off all of these other portals that exist in different countries, different functions, and feed it all into our new platform. So I guess that was maybe the bigger change. But I mean, things are just changing and people are trying out stuff all the time, which seems to work.
Jamie, you mentioned a partnership with HR. Is that where you fall under, or is that just necessary to get your job done?
That's where I sit. So I'm based in the global HR function. We've kind of been on a bit of a journey the last few years, though. So if you go back like 3 years or so, probably 90% of our training was done through different parts of the business. So sales owned their own stuff, big chunks of retail owned their own stuff. And that has its advantages, but it makes it really difficult to do stuff in a coordinated way with common standards across the business. So we took the decision at that time to move not all, but most of the headcount, the resource into HR functions in different countries, so that at least then we're sort of part of the one family, and that then I think looking back, if we hadn't done that, aligning our resource, aligning our budgets, we could never do half this stuff because it would have been too hard to break through into all the other functions. Now you're part of the one HR family, so you just go out and people are kind of up for doing stuff.
All right, I'm gonna make you move and get active before you go. A nice point of reflection here would be if you could talk to the person next to you about what you've seen and how you might use some of this information in your current environment. And then with that, we'll just kind of see what bubbles up from that. It's always nice to see who you're sitting next to in a session like this. And then we'll hear final words from Jamie and Richard on this. So turn to the person next to you and just talk about anything you've seen that you want to do. All right. So I'm curious, what is everyone thinking? What tidbit or what are they going to bring back with them? What was highlighted here that really resonated for you? I'm going to start with the back, just because I can and it's fun. Anybody want to share what you talked about?
We were talking about some of the gamification elements of what you were talking about. And we were doing that thing where we were saying gamification can drive some behaviors, but sometimes the kind of stickiness of the learning doesn't necessarily stay. So it's that really clever balance between gamifying something so that I'm up for doing it, but making it meaningful enough that it's not just snap, yeah, forgotten. So we were sort of talking about that stuff and how do you do that? So and one of the examples was getting learners to sort of say, this is what I've learned, and giving them, you know, badges or numbers or whatever for the quality of their contribution. Rather than just,
So it's really impressive what you guys have done, and the company that I work for is nowhere close to this, so this is almost dreamy to me. But I was wondering, as you move to a more and more electronic platform for learning, I guess that replaced a lot of your more traditional classroom training. Did you face, and do you continuously face resistance to digital learning versus classroom and face-to-face interaction? And then how do you handle that?
Okay. Classroom training is massive in our business. As you can imagine, it supports exams and so forth, but it's expensive. And more and more, it moves centrally, so usually to London. And people come from all over the country, in fact, from Europe as well. So the answer is probably no, but it's slowly migrating more towards digital learning. But at this moment in time, what I'd say is that people are probably using both in harness. So I certainly didn't find anybody really pushing back against it. It's been an easy step for us. I mean, I certainly didn't see any negativity. I think sometimes as long as you actually show people what it is, and sometimes we say, look, take this and use it for nothing and see where you are. And it's amazing, within 3 months, it's embedded. And they see that really as a really powerful, powerful way forward.
Great. Jamie?
In the main, no. We're kind of lucky that from our company, there's a sort of big appreciation of mobile and sort of newer technologies. So in the main, no. Where we have faced some challenges, though, is some countries, like internet connections, internet technologies are not very good. So you try to run, virtual classrooms and stuff in some of our African operations, and that just doesn't work very well. So you face some challenges that way. And if I go back a couple of years, the other challenge was content wasn't good enough. We were rolling out like crap e-learning. Seriously, I look at it now and I'm ashamed. It was really poor. Thankfully, the tools are much better. The partners that we have are sort of much better and innovating in a way that they didn't a few years ago. So people now get the content. And they're like, yeah, that's cool. I like that, and it kind of sells itself.
Great. Any other topics that came up? Yes.
It comes off the back of that, really. I'm coming at it from a slightly different angle. In fact, I work for a small web development agency, delivering e-learning solutions for a big client. and we give them all the tools, and we're not far off where you guys are in terms of the gamification and game-enabled learning. But what are you doing with the data, and what are your tips, I guess, for handling the data to ensure that the content is good and it's of value, and there are benefits coming out the other side? Because I think that's where we need to get to at the next stage. That's it.
So I think the data is. I don't know how much you've talked about data these last couple of days. I guess quite a lot. But I think next few years is the big data opportunity. So the intelligence, most of the data is there actually. So in different places, in different tools and systems, the data is there. Our biggest problem is trying to connect it all up in a way that's valuable to our business. So right now, the tools that I shared with you, I'm not getting a huge amount of valuable data out of. But when we've got some smart people in our business analytics function looking at it, and they're taking some of the learning data, and they're comparing it with like our sales data, and they're looking at outputs on our customers' data, and then they can paint some very compelling pictures around, okay, so what's your real return on investment? If you train X, what's your Y? And we started doing that in a sales space. That's why I've got some sort of tangible numbers to give. Even, you know, our higher performing teams, our higher engaged teams from people surveys and stuff, from a training point of view, what makes the difference one over another? So if out of a scale of 1 to 10, 1 being rubbish, 10 being completely cracked it, we're probably like a 2.5 on data at the moment. But I'd love to, in probably 18 months, 2 years, be able to say, yeah, we'll be up to a 7 or 8, hopefully, because it's a huge opportunity. We're just not quite there yet.
All right. So final words of wisdom to send them off into the world. No pressure. We'll start with Richard.
Okay. I suppose the one slide I left off, which was what I've really learned on this journey, considering what I was actually doing, which is rebuilding something from scratch. One is get your hands dirty. Don't trust research agencies. They're great for some stuff, but they're not great for stuff like this. You really have to get in front of people and choose the people carefully. Just don't go and see just the managers. Go and see the people who work for the managers. Go and see all the people who you consider to be the stakeholders. And don't accept their first answer. People don't want to offend you. They're very, very nice. They say everything's fantastic. This is the best thing they've ever seen. And I'm looking at the MI saying, you're a bloody liar, because I can see you're not using it. You know. And then you still have to ask the other question. It's probably stuff that the research agency wouldn't know how to do. So you've almost got to get, so definitely that. The content matters massively. It doesn't matter which level you're operating at. You need to get the content right. I mean, every time, all the money that we spent on developing this content, I kept on thinking to myself, how valuable will this be in 12 months, 18 months, and so forth? And I kept on thinking, it probably won't, we'll have moved on. But actually, you need that because it gives you the data, and that really empowers you then to deal with leaders and so forth. And the other thing, really, which is something we all know, every one of us in this room, is to make it relevant. And you can't really go over the top with this, so think about the roles, because when you get learning yourself, you surely look at it and think, how relevant is this to me? And if it isn't, you just do that thing that everybody else does. You just go boom, 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 and just walk through it, and it actually means nothing. So it's worth spending a bit of time to make things relevant. And a final point is when you've arrived and you've delivered your project, don't think you've done it, because immediately you're already behind. And so that's the biggest goal. I think biggest thing for working in this industry, it really is, don't spend time celebrating too much. You need to be about 18 months ahead.
Yeah, we actually in an earlier session discussed that same point, stating you have to keep it healthy. Mm-hmm. Maintenance, almost build that into the project plan mm-hmm. to keep it going, because it's out of date the minute it gets out there, right? Mm-hmm. That's a great point. Mm-hmm. Jamie?
I mean, like, I'm not sure any words of wisdom. The just a couple of points was, I think simplicity is just so important. Life is too complex as it is. So So to get simplicity, I think you need to start from your employees, your end users' sort of point of view, and work your way back from there in a way that makes sense to them, not necessarily in the way that your LMS tells you to or your IT guys tell you to. I think the other thing is, at least if you're part of large organisations, you've got to segment your audience in a smart way. So know who they are, segment them up into sort of key target groups, and then tailor your stuff to them. Channel it so it's relevant and it makes sense to them. We're learning how to do that. I think last thing is you know, make it fun, memorable, make it an engaging experience, because you know, everyone wants to enjoy what they're doing, right? And I think learning is a fantastic way to do it.
All right. Well, we took a picture of you guys while you were discussing, so we're going to be tweeting that out. I thought I hadn't seen any of the actual audiences. Thank you so much for your participation, and have a great evening.